Welcome back to the Morning Skate. We are another daytime edition, so you know it's just Brownie with no Ked because he can't do anything in the daytime. But I am joined today by, we have another Howlin Huskies playlist entry right here. We are joined by grad student Lily Yovetich joining the podcast. Yovo, how are you doing today?
I'm good. Thanks for having me. It's a pleasure to be here this morning.
Great to have you. So currently 4-3-1, 2-1-1 in Hockey East and ranked 14th. Feeling, I mean, some fits and starts, but.
Yeah, I mean, I think just based on our past, we want to be better, but we'll take it. Not a bad start for sure.
Yeah, I think it was a big weekend. I'm counting Friday with as a win. I think it's a 2-win weekend. You know, I know they call it a tie and then a shootout win, but we're calling it a 2-win weekend. And I think that was huge for you guys to get that, second win. You know, you guys, that there's been that let up, I feel, on Saturdays a little bit. And this one, Saturday was a definitive moment. I think it was good.
Yeah, no, I would agree with you on that. That was something, a goal of ours since the season started, was just string together a full weekend of 2 wins. So definitely something to draw on as we enter this weekend, which is Providence.
Yeah, and then you only have one though, right? Only Friday.
Yes, only one. So we can leave it all out there.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. That's a weird one. Me and Delaney were talking about that. It's just an odd little, like she said, with the travel, it's just an odd little thing because you have to play everybody 3 times in Hockey East, which I never, in all the years covering you guys, I never put that together that it was 3 games a season.
Oh, I had no idea. I just feel like we play everyone all the time. But that's news to me too. But yeah, no. I feel like we never have any buys, so 1 weekend or 1 game a weekend, it's probably the closest thing we'd get to that.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. All right, so let's go back a little bit. So I, in doing research for you coming on, I would say that you have one of the probably most interesting and unique journeys to a D1 hockey program of people that I've spoken to. I mean, to you, it's normal because it's your only one, but so you, are you dual citizenship?
Yes. Yes.
Oh, nice. I'm working on it. My dad's family's from Saskatchewan, so I have to get him to get it. Then I can get it. You know, you have to work backwards. Cool. Yeah.
Definitely get it. I love that hat, by the way. The hat's sick.
Oh, yeah. There's an old one. I got this years ago when we were up there for a tournament. So you grew up, born in Ottawa, grew up in the hockey hotbed of Beverly Hills. Yes.
Yes. Just outside, not Beverly Wood, but I went.
Okay. So you won't remember this, but a few years ago, I brought my daughter to the game and there was a team there, a youth team that went into the locker room after the game. And Carp was like, oh, bring your daughter in. And she clearly was like shy, you know, because it was a whole team. And then she was just there. And you won't remember this, but you came over and talked to her and was like, how are you doing? Where are you from? And you told her you were from California. And my daughter was like, what? California? It was a great moment. So
I do remember that.
Do you? Oh, that's great.
I actually do remember that. That's really awesome. Oh, that's
I told her that I told her this morning that you were coming on and she's like, should I stay home from school? I'm like, no, you shouldn't stay home from school. You can go to school. I'll tell her you said hi. So how did you get your start in hockey or skating in general? Was it roller or did someone in your family get you going?
I have an older brother and both my parents are Canadian. So it was kind of just kind of without saying that we were all going to play. And I wanted to be just like my older brother. So when he started to play, he's 2 years older than me. My parents were like, okay, you can jump into, we're going to be here anyways at the rink. So
was there ice? You had ice, plenty of opportunity with ice in California?
There was honestly probably 3, maybe 4 now major ice rinks. Back then, definitely only 2. And it was the rink that the LA Kings practice out of. Yep. So not super close and not really accessible, but my parents found a way. I guess they wanted us to play that badly, but
yeah, it works. I mean, look, clearly it worked. And you played other sports growing up, multi-sport?
Yeah, my I played soccer. I was pretty good at soccer growing up. And then I also played lacrosse in high school for 4 years. So that was really fun to be a part of high school sports.
So I saw you had a 9-goal game in lacrosse.
Yeah, it was the craziest thing. Because if you look at my stats now, like I'm not a big goal scorer. But in lacrosse, I could just run really fast. And it was like a hockey stick. And no one's ever played before. So we played like a really terrible, I think it was like Culver City or like Pali, like Palos Verdes. And I, for whatever reason, I just was really hot that game.
So you're in your fifth year. I'm sure you've heard about Karp's 7-goal game in lacrosse.
No, I haven't.
Oh my gosh. So I was Karp's high school coach in lacrosse.
That's right. I did know that.
And we had a game. I think it was to get us in the tourney at the mass level. You play like you play your regular season. Then if you make the MIAA tourney, it's like a big deal to even make the tourney. And I think it was to get us in the tourney that Karp got 7. They just couldn't stop him that day. And I just kept calling his number because I was the offensive coach. And I just kept having him go. I think you need to be like, oh, hey, Brownie told me you had a 7-goal game. And he'll go on and on and be like, yeah, I mean, 2 more and it would have been like mine. You know, that'll be nice. Yeah.
That's a great idea. I will bring that up.
He'll always nice to get Karp that way. So did you grow up, like, were you a hockey fan growing up? Kings, Ducks, or Senators because of your family?
Yeah. I mean, we didn't watch a ton of hockey. Both my siblings played, so I was always either in the car or at the rink.
Yeah.
But we would go to a lot of Kings games. There was always opportunities growing up in the youth program, the junior Kings, where it was like, oh, like, bring your team to the game. Right. So we would go watch them play a lot. And weirdly enough, they'd always play the Rangers. So I've seen the Rangers play quite a bit. But yeah, definitely should have watched more hockey growing up. But
there's no wrong answer there. So I was asking, because was there someone that you watched that you were like, oh, I like the way that person plays. I'm going to kind of pattern my game after that person.
Not necessarily. My family and probably like everyone, they get really big into the Olympics and the Olympic hockey. And so growing up, I watched Haley Wickenheiser, Mary Philip Poulain. And so those were players that I definitely tried to pull bits and pieces from to apply to my game and be like, okay, like these are the people that are kind of inspiring me to be the player that I am or want to become.
It's funny you mentioned Wickenheiser. There's a person at my daughter's school whose last name is Wickenheiser, which is not a common name. And I'm so like, I don't know who they are. So every school event, I'm always wearing like hockey stuff, waiting for someone to be like, oh, hey, you know, and I just need to ask who they are so I can be like, hey, are you related? They have to be, you know.
That would be crazy. You have to get back to me, please.
just to find out if they're there.
Yeah. No, that'd be sick.
So when you went from the LA, first, before I forget this, the Junior Kings, you only played 5 games, but you played with Dustin Wolf.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know why it said 5 games. I played like
a season, right?
Yeah, I played 2 full seasons. Oh. I played in the AA team, but I played with him. I played with Brennan Brisson, Drew Hellison, Jackson Lacombe.
Oh, wow.
I played against Cole Caulfield.
No big deal.
Not a big deal. Alex Turcotte, Jack Hughes. No, I was just – and all those boys – they are all from, and their dads ran the team, like Rob Blake, Nelson Emerson, and then Pat Brisson. They were the coaches of our team. So we all kind of grew up together. And
that's great.
It was such a small world, but I've known them forever. So it's
good. Oh, that's awesome.
Watching them play now, I'm like, oh my God, like that could have been me.
Yeah. Who knows? Well, it still could. So when you, I saw that you went, from the Kings to like the, and the which is awful that they still call it the Lady Ducks, but yeah, they could just be the Ducks.
Yeah, I hate it. It's terrible.
The youth, but you had, I could see your through your progression at the youth level. You could see your competition kind of ramp as you move forward. You had a few D1 players that you played with and against. With the Lady Ducks. I'm not going to say that anymore. Just the Ducks. And you won the U.S. Nationals your second year?
No. I think there was like a typo when they asked for that information, and I've never gone back to be like, hey, that's actually wrong. I think we won one game at Nationals ever. Like, I think it was like we won one game.
This is the morning skate difference right here. This is what Karp gives me a hard time for, our top-notch research. But I did
it's art.
Yeah.
It's art. It's on my side of things.
Well, I will say this is something with women's game is getting better is like Hockey DB, which is such a great source for everybody. It's starting to incorporate now some of the women players, which is it's way overdue, but at least it's coming. You know, it's a slow, it's like pushing that boulder up the hill. So after the Ducks, you went to the Provincial Women's Hockey League, which I think is hilarious that it's the PWHL.
I know.
Yeah, it's just crazy. So could you tell the difference from Southern California to the PWHL, the competition? Can you feel it?
Oh, completely. I thought, like, I had no experience with girls hockey growing up at all in California, yep, other than the Ducks, and they were terrible. Like, I was a centerman. That's how bad they were. And so when I went to the P-Dub, I was like, oh, my God, like, I am not as good as I thought I was. So it was definitely, like, a rude awakening, but it was the best because I got to play against because also they had, like, an import rule. So only two Americans, and I was Canadian, but all the Team USA girls that were, like, U18, like Katie Knoll,
yeah,
Kiara Zanin, some of those big names, they came over and they played. So it's kind of like the best of the best with Philly A. She also played in the league, the Gosselin twins, or not twins, the sister cousins. And so it was like kind of like you're playing against now, or I guess future Olympians. And even at the time, they were still really dominant. So it was really fun. It was a really competitive league for sure.
So was now with, so you were like what? You were 16-ish in that range?
Yeah, 16 to 19. So it was some good years there.
Did you feel like when you talk about having that, oh my gosh, moment, was that a conscious, like, oh my gosh, I need to dial it in practice? Or did you have that? Because I look back at like when I was 16 and I was like, who's got a fake ID, right? That was like our main focus. And it's just great to talk with you guys, top athletes. And it's always like, that's when it clicked that I needed to shoot an extra 100 pucks after practice. That's when I needed to work my wall game or whatever it may be. Did you have that conscious thought? Do you remember that?
Honestly, we growing up with the players that I did always gave us access to top-notch practice times,
yeah,
extra skills sessions. And I feel like that kind of work ethic with the boys side, at least in California, is way more than it is on the girl side. So for me, it was like, oh, like we're not doing nearly as much as I used to do with the boys. I know how hard I can work.
Gotcha.
Now that I'm not getting it here, I'll have to get it somewhere else. But it was just more like, okay, I have to go and do it myself since I'm not being coached through it. I'll have to go to the gym by myself and do more. So it was more just, I guess, independence is what I kind of gained. I guess boys and girls, the boys need to be really forced into showing kind of how to work hard. And the girls, it's up to you to make a conscious decision if you want to work hard or not. Because a lot of girls didn't want to play Division One, even, yeah, though it was such a great league. Like there was a lot of girls that wanted to stay close to home, and they were just there because they didn't have the option yet to go to college.
Gotcha. What about the physical side of the game? For those that don't get to see you play, you have no problem with the physical side of the game within the rules. But when going from playing with the boys to going to the provincial, was there like, I know there's the age thing. There's no checking at different ages, but was there a conversation about, hey, you can't run people in this league? Or yeah, was there that kind of conversation?
Yeah, definitely. I actually lived with a coach I played for the Barrie Sharks my first year, and his daughter's Jessie Eldridge. She is like a really awesome Canadian women's hockey player. But anyways, I got like, I think like 60 or 80 penalty minutes that year. But he told me, he was just like, you're here to score goals. You're not here to be a goon. And my dad would always kind of tell me that, because he'd just be like, I'm not here to, we're not coming all the way to Stony Creek, Toronto for you to sit in the box. But it was definitely just learning the difference between edging someone out and full on doing like a body check. But that was just something that like you're never taught. And now, right, I feel like especially as they want to kind of prepare college players for the P-Dub and how physical it is, like there's a learning curve. Like, yeah, it's still like, we don't really know. You aren't taught that. Like I was taught how to hit at age 12. And so I feel like in a lot of the girls that did play boys hockey, we have that skill set that it's very different. It's not what we're used to.
It's also, it's crazy in your career, which is short, it's gone full circle, right? It's come all the way back around. And I've talked to Carp about this, about, and I talked to Berm too. It's the recruiting now is going to start to change as the physicality rolls down. I mean, it would be nice. And don't you say a word on this, but it would be nice if the NCAA officials maybe were a little more consistent. You just keep quiet here. I don't want you to get in trouble. Delaney will kill me. But it would be nice to have that. Like that was the first thing I asked Carp this year. I was like, did Hockey East officials talk to you and be like, hey, this is what we're looking for. This is the new line. He's like, no, they, you know, that's not been a conversation, which would been, I think would be helpful. You know, to have that, you know, roll it down.
I think so. I think so much of it too is also preventative. Like if you learn and you know how to hit, you're able to hold up and be like, okay, like she is in that danger zone on the boards. Yeah. And I know she's going to turn. I'm not going to put my shoulder into her numbers. Like that's kind of also part of my frustration too, is like it's girls don't know how to hit. And then they think they do, and girls don't know how to take hits at the same time.
That's the bigger part of it, I think, that you don't know how to take the hit, and you don't know how to absorb it or use the glass, you know, to absorb that hit or to fall the right way. And I think that's why last weekend at Holy Cross, in the Holy Cross series, there must have been three or four different times where players were out on the ice, like stretched out, and it was like, oh my gosh. Because, again, it's, you know, I'm not saying they do anything wrong. It's just they don't know how to take the hit. I feel
no. No, yeah. Definitely. And, like, even going back to your comment about full circle, I remember my brother was even at the point at his, like, when he was of age where they were trying to decide if they were doing checking in peewees or pushing it back to Bantams. Like, it's been –
yeah,
been really talked about throughout my generation. It's kind of crazy to see how we're now going back to that.
I remember they did they had for a while, the big thing was that orange, the orange paint, the 2 feet around the boards. Have you been on a rink that had that?
Yes, I remember that. That was crazy.
That's gone away too. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. There's only one rink that I've been on that had that. And we were like, what the heck? The first time we saw it, we didn't know what it was.
But it's so weird because even like I have a little brother and there was a time period because now he's playing in Canada, but you couldn't finish your check. That was a USA hockey rule. Like once you got rid of the puck, like you didn't have that 3 second rule anymore for someone to get up in your face, which I thought was really interesting. It was like USA hockey really wanted to pull back that physicality, where I feel like the major junior and the more Canadian leagues just kind of wanted to like push that.
They wanted too many guys were admiring their passes. That's why. And they were just like, oh, look at that. And they didn't want them to get lit up anymore.
Yeah. No, yeah. Fair enough.
All right. So Northeastern, how did you end up on the other side of the country? Were you talking to a lot of schools or did you know where you wanted to go?
Yes and no. Northeastern showed interest because, again, back in my time, you didn't have that rule where you had to wait until your junior year to have any form of communication. So we were kind of communicating with coaches at the age of 13. I remember I was at a tournament and Coach Carp had told one of my coaches that they really liked me as a player and were going to be watching me. So for me, that always kind of held a special place in my heart because they were the first school to even show any form of interest. So we continued to bridge that gap of communication for the next couple years. And then I think around 16, I verbally committed. But I don't know why, for whatever reason, I always wanted to come to Northeastern. I really liked Coach Carp and Coach Flint. Coach Berm wasn't there yet.
That's crazy. You were there before you committed before Berm was there. That's funny.
Well, I'm her first year. my parents and I talk about it. Like we're her first, because my other Abby Marone, she's not with us anymore, but her and I, we were like her OG.
Oh yeah. And you're the last of the COVID year. You're the last of the extra year. Yeah.
Yeah.
I just saw Abby at the game the other day. She was there watching.
Oh no, yes, she was. Oh, okay. I didn't know if you knew her. That's amazing. She's
the greatest. Yeah.
I miss her a lot. Yeah.
Abby's a good kid. Did you know any of the players coming into Northeastern, or by personality or reputation? Or I mean, you probably knew some of them by name.
I grew up with Peyton Anderson. Her and I were at a multi-district camp, so I've known her since I was like 12. But other than that, no, I didn't know anyone was never really, growing up, I was never really a fan of the Massachusetts girls, which is so ironic because they're all on my team now and they're the best. But
was it due to the accent or the hacking behind the play, or
there was kind of like a Minnesota Boston rivalry, and I was from neither, so I just was somewhere in the middle and always kind of with the Minnesota girls. So I just kind of like, oh, Boston. But I so take that back and eat my words now.
No, it's fine. It's listen, there's a long tradition of Massachusetts people, myself included, being proud of the fact that people don't like us. So it's been a long standing tradition. I mean, you go all the way back to the Miracle movie with the the real miracle when that team, there was that Minnesota Boston rivalry.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's not new. So it's good to hear that it's in the women's game as well.
Oh, yeah. Of course.
So number 16, was that always your number through youth, or was there any special significance?
Yeah. My dad played college football growing up in Canada. And he wore number 16.
Oh, okay.
And then my older brother, he took up the number 16. And then all throughout our youth years, we all wore number 16. So it's kind of like our family number.
No, that's great. That's awesome. Now, I know you were a scorer growing up, as you said. You were the can we talk about, do you know that about your goal for Holy Cross, your one career goal last year? Do you know that I called that in the blog?
No way, really?
So you guys had, it was a Friday, Saturday, and Friday night, I said in the blog, that the write-up or whatever, I wrote, hey, like one of the notes down below, and this is, all of our normal listeners are going to be like, oh my God, we knew it was only a matter of time before he brought this up. I wrote like, hey, no pressure, Yovo, but I'm calling a goal for you tomorrow night. And then you scored, and I think you scored at Matthews. Were you at Matthews for the goal?
No, we were
on the road. It was on the road.
Yeah.
But you scored, and I text Carp during the game sometimes. I know he won't see it, but I texted him. I'm like, called it. And he just was like the eye roll emoji. But I even put it to the screenshot of the blog with the timestamp the next day of the write-up. So
no way. That's awesome.
Yeah. So I was hoping you were going to do it again to them this past weekend. You had a couple of nice shots.
I can't buy one, but thanks for saying it 4 years too late.
Well, I will say this. There's one thing I've noticed. I don't know if you're with us. You know, your shots on goal have gone up every year.
I sure as heck hope so. I had like 5 shots my first year.
But that's great though. I mean, it's trending in the right direction.
You sound like my dad. My dad's like, your probability is terrible. He's like, it's like you try to miss the net. Like, and I'm like, okay, guy. He's like, you've like a 0.00. And I'm like, I know. I know.
But listen, I've talked to your coaches about you and stuff, and the one thing they say about the one common theme is like how hard you work, how fast you are, but then like the grit and the resiliency. And Berm pointed out how you've worked your way up to, you're anchoring the top pair, you know, and that's what you want. You want to see that kind of projection. So let's go back to your freshman year. You started off right away. You played 24 games first year. From arriving on campus, the game wasn't too fast. The systems, you picked it up, no problems, no issues.
It was a nightmare, in all honesty. It was Molly, Annie, Abby, and I, the four of us. And it's so crazy because it's so different now. But when we showed up, it was like, there's four of us. Everyone else is the old team. Everyone knows everything. No one told us anything. It was kind of like, okay, like monkey see, monkey do, and like step or be stepped on. And so we had to learn really quickly, even though we were really fortunate that there were opportunities for us to come in and earn a spot. But it was like we'd be looking around and be like, oh, so what's this like 2-on-2? Like what? Because none of us had done.
You mean even like the drills in practice? No one?
Because we'd be like, okay, Dartmouth. And everyone would get up and we're like, what? And no one wanted to talk to, like, everyone was, so it's like, hey, should we talk to her? Like, 42, like, she looks nice. And it was Tessa Ward.
Oh, Tessa, yeah, yeah.
Little did I know, like, that's, like, the one person that you just stay clear of your first week or your first 2 years.
I had her on the podcast. She was fantastic. She was so funny.
She's the best, like, an absolute riot. But just as a freshman, you're terrified of her. Like, she's a scary upperclassman, but... It was, we learned it, but it was with no help, actually.
Oh, so that was the three overtime bean pot, right? With Lauren McInnes. Wasn't that your freshman year?
That was the year after.
Okay. Okay. It's hard when you try to match it up, like on like Wikipedia or I'm telling you right now, the bean pot women's, I don't want to get you in trouble, so you keep quiet, but the bean pot women's side online, like tighten it up. That's all I'm asking. Just tighten it up a little bit with the issues there. So yeah, you came in with Griffin, Abby, who retired, and Annie Fitzgerald over at BU now. Yeah. So you walked in with basically to an all-star team, right? If you look at that roster, I mean, Frankel, Skylar Fontaine, McInnes, Hobson, Chloe, Murph, Alina, Mia Brown, Andrea Renner, Megan Carter, Katie Knoll, Peyton Anderson. It literally was like an all-star team. And then we're not even talking about like Ward and some of those other players that didn't have the big minutes as well. So your sophomore year, your confidence, you could see it in your play, your confidence ramped up, your physicality ramped up also. You went from 12 penalty minutes to 22 penalty minutes. You played all games. That was the Hockey East champ second. That was your second Hockey East championship. That was over UConn that year. And then the Frozen Four for the second year in a row. What are the big moments of like the Frozen Four that stick out to you besides like how it ended or any of the experience?
Yeah, it was so memorable. Obviously, definitely those moments stick out to me and will for the rest of my life. But one particular moment was that first year. It was that COVID year. We played Wisconsin and we lost to them in overtime. Mm-hmm. But we weren't able to see our parents for the whole. So I hadn't seen my parents for 8-9 months and I was a freshman.
Yeah.
And I remember that was so emotional because my dad, my mom, and my little brother were at the hotel leading up to all those games because we were there for like a week, but we weren't allowed to see them and we weren't allowed to hug them. So I was able to see them from like very far and wave. And it was so emotional because it was like, yes, like it was awful and everything that we lost. But like, it was all just about getting through it so we could see our parents. Like it was.
Yeah.
And so everyone just got to like hug. And like, I remember I just sat up with my parents and just like sat so close to them. And it was like unlike anything. I felt like I'd gone to war for like 5 years and I finally got to see them. But that was definitely, I cried for sure.
That's great though. And then with the Minnesota Duluth, that was that phantom call on Chloe is, I'll say it again, you keep quiet. I don't want you to get in any trouble, but that was a pretty bad call.
It's like people don't like us.
What do you mean?
I feel like sometimes we get these really crazy call circumstance issues. And then it's like, okay, wow. Like the last time we were there that.
Yeah. You really want to get into it. We could talk about the missed boarding call on Riley Jones at UConn last year. I mean, come on. Again, you keep quiet. I don't want you to get in any trouble. Let the lady get mad at me, not you. even the security guard at UConn who was right there with me, he's like, Brownie, that was boarding, right? I'm like, yeah. In every rink in America, that was boarding. I feel like, I'm not criticizing the officials because it's a high-pressure situation. It's very fast-paced. But I feel, and I don't have the experience watching like ECAC or the Midwest as much, but I feel in Hockey East that sometimes the officials don't want to call they officiate the clock, if that makes sense. You guys could be, let's say you're up by two with 3 minutes left and you have the game totally in hand. Other teams will start taking liberties and they should be whistled and they don't. And I've seen it both ways and I don't understand that mentality. And I get it for my beer league games, the refs want to get out of there. We all got to work in the morning. That I understand if you wave off an icing. But at the NCAA Division One, it shouldn't matter the time, the place. If it's an infraction, you should make that call. And all right, I'm going to get off my soapbox before I get both of you in trouble.
No, that's a really interesting topic. I haven't heard anyone talk about that before, but that's very true. I definitely, like when you bring that up, I definitely... It's like, oh, and people pull their whistles. No, I mean, I had to go to my coaches this year and I asked Berm and I was like, hey, like, can I get a penalty after the game talking to the refs? And she's like, well, it depends on what you say. But like, I've gotten up even this year and just been like, it's been terrible. And not even from a point of, oh, like calls didn't go our way. It was, okay, people are going to get hurt. Like, yeah. It's not even about getting a power play. It's like, okay, like you need to let her know so she doesn't do this again to someone smaller that can't handle it. And God forbid, like their ACLs are torn. Like that's, that's especially to the someone that's been in college hockey and has made it healthy, knock on wood, for 5 years. We have lives to live. Like I'm not trying to hurt myself. No one is in my last year. I'm just kind of like, okay, yeah, like I.
Yeah, well, could be your last year. Could be more.
No, yeah, but I that's my kind of leading thing is keep us safe. Like your job is to.
That's the number one priority, and I feel like that gets lost sometimes. Yeah, no, I agree with you. I will say this, and I've noticed this. I didn't notice it prior, and I don't know if it's Taze just doing this, but after warmups, Taze, Allard, and Molly all go to the refs and like shake their hands and have like a chat with them. And I'm like, I don't remember Carter ever doing that. I don't remember Alina ever doing that. Hey, it's good gamemanship by Taze if that's what she's doing. And if it's working, good on her, you know?
Yeah, I mean, maybe Carter should have done that.
All right, so your junior year, this is when you seem to, in my opinion, figure it all out. And I think not just you, I think it happens with everybody. I remember when Irving got to her junior year, it was like, oh, yeah. This, I get it now. This is when I feel like you were starting to be matched up with the top line from the other team quite a bit. Did you feel you were now looked at as like to the freshman coming in, the deer in the headlights? Were you that like, oh, we can go ask Yovo? Or did you keep it as when you were a freshman?
No, I mean, I think I look at you as my junior year. It was definitely a pinnacle point in my career, but not for the reasons that people think. I actually was scratched from my first time my junior year, and I was the bottom of the depth chart for the first 2 months.
At the beginning. Okay. I was talking more towards the end. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, yeah. And I guess I only bring that up just because it was important for me to know, because at least at Northeastern sometimes, and I'm sure at other schools, but once you kind of are confined to a role, confined to a box, it's very hard to get out of there. And when you have so much skill and talent coming in every year, it's kind of game by game and whoever's playing good and whoever is healthy, but you can be buried. Like, yep. And once you're buried mentally, it's very hard to get into that. But I was fortunate enough that there was injuries and I got my shit together, but it was more just like, I hated the feeling so much of watching and feeling like I should be out there that I just, that's what fueled me to want to be the one and really hone in on defense. Cause I was like, okay, like in order for me to play, I have to be like Sky Fontaine and Hobby. But I learned really quickly that was not going to be my role. And instead I was just going to be good at something that we really needed to, which was defense. And so I latched onto Carter really quickly. And I kind of knew that if I can kind of cater my game to a supporting role to her, that would be the best opportunity for me to get the most minutes and to do what I thought was best, which was defend.
So this now, that's interesting that you had that kind of self-dialogue, right? Was that something that was like laid out for you, or was that you kind of going, you know what? And it's like when you talked about going to the provincial league, it's a similar kind of reset, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think because there's so many players that there was always a fear that if you didn't play well and you got scratched and you were in that lower position, that it was going to be really, you never knew when your shot was coming again.
Yep.
And so it was more just like, okay, like I'm going to be ready for when my opportunity does come. And I don't want anything bad, but if someone does slip up, then it's just an opportunity for me to get back in there. But it wasn't like a full reset. It was more like, okay, like your biggest fear is now staring you in the face, which is being scratched. It's not as bad as you thought it was, even though like you are losing sleep at night. Like, what are you going to do about it? Cause I can't live this way. I was like,
I'm not.
Cause some people pack it in and they're just like, I've seen it with so many girls. And that was the thing. It's like, I'd seen it happen so many times ahead of me. And it's like, wow, like this girl's played 60 games in her career and she didn't touch the ice for the rest of her time here. Like, so you're like, and then you start to awfulize and you're like, that could be me or it could not be me. And the difference is you're just ready for every opportunity that it comes.
It is crazy from the outside, like to have no knowledge of that, right? All I thought about, like from my vantage point, looking at your junior year, I was like, oh, this is when she figured it all out. This is when she, you know, kind of took off. And you had no idea the struggles. And that's something that people should keep in mind too when they're watching pros, college, whoever it is, any athlete. You still got to remember that it's a person there that is trying to do their best. So when you're like, get back on the back check, well, there's other things leading up to that. Yeah.
No, definitely. And I think too that, and it makes you realize too, like the Lena Mueller's and Erin Frankel, I guess she would understand, but like the Lena Mueller's, like who's never, the people that have never been on that other side of it, it's so much more than it's like, oh, like she's not playing well. It's like, this kid is so nervous because this is her first shift.
Yeah.
She knows that if she doesn't do not something crazy, but just not something bad, then she's not going to get another shift. And that's her opportunity. Like girls will get games and not have a single shift and then not see the ice again for the rest of the year. And it's like so cutthroat, and that's how good the skill is, and that's how competitive it is. But it is so, no one talks about that. And I think that's why we make such great employees and such good bosses, because we're dealing with these big, heavy emotions all at the same time as contributing to a team and contributing to all the emotions and everything as a whole. It's a lot. I commend
it. Me out just talking about it with you.
Yeah, but like we love it. Like it wouldn't change a thing. But I at least two in my last year, I'm trying to like gain or keep perspective on that, because it's like, okay, like in the summertime, like I don't feel this. Like I don't feel the stress and the pressure, but I love it. Like I'm gonna miss it when it's gone. It's definitely a privilege for sure.
Well, that's gonna get into that whole rut where if you're like the spare defenseman or the fourth line, and then it's you're squeezing your stick, you're trying to get out there and you want to make something happen no matter what, or then you're like you stay out too long and then that could run back the other way, or you're afraid of changing at the wrong time. And yeah, it's a lot, man. And it's crazy. And then that's why they say like a guy like Gretzky or Michael Jordan, they don't make the greatest coaches, because they don't understand that feeling of having that pressure to perform. I mean, they do, but it's a different type of feeling, if that makes sense. Yeah, that's interesting. Listen, well, you from the outside appearances, you look like you were doing great in your junior year. So that was good.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Well, so now your senior year, you and Carter were the top pair, shutdown pair. And I mean, talk about the goals. I felt like you fed her a little too much, but maybe, you know, she that was the game plan. You had the big bean pot at the Garden. What do you remember about that? I mean, it was unbelievable. I was there. I thought I was gonna have a heart attack watching. It was crazy. I was getting like anxiety up in the press box. It was
my dad was there. And one thing he said to me was, hey, like, take a moment to, like, take in the crowd. He's like, there's not going to be many moments that you're going to be in like this ever again. So I remember, like, sitting up during warm-ups and just, like taking a deep breath. Like, we all had, like, self-tan the night before. Like, our hair's braided. Everyone's makeup looks good. And I just remember standing there. And then, like, I get a puck in my skate and I, like, fall. And every pass is just not where it's supposed to be. And I'm like, okay, like the crowd's great, but like, and I'm starting to kind of get nervous. I'm like, okay, like all you need to do is just make that first pass. Like, all you need to do when the puck drops and you get the puck on your stick, just make the first pass. So I was really nervous. And then the puck dropped. Carter and I hinged like we always do. And I just remember hitting Peyton Anderson in the weak side. And I finally took a deep breath. And the rest of the game just kind of like took hold of itself. But I have this doubt of panic sometimes. And I felt it. And I only feel it in good games. In like big games that are going to be good, but I'm literally standing there, I'm like, oh my God, I don't know if I could do this. And then it's like, boom. Okay. Never mind. I'm good. But it was, I draw in that moment a lot. Whenever I get nervous, for sure.
So that feeling, that nervous feeling, did you have that in any of the NCAA, the Frozen Four stuff? Did you also?
This sounds so weird, but I feel like I could say it when I was in the Frozen Four. I guess not the time the last time when we lost against Ohio in the semis, I felt it because I was like, oh shit, like it's on us. Like, but yeah. Before with Sky Fontaine and Hobby, like I was like, wow, like I got to do the bare minimum. They never let me.
I got the door for you.
Yeah. I got the door. Like, you go and do your thing. Your water will be full. Like, yeah. It was just a completely different like vibe. Yeah. Just like, don't mess up. Meanwhile, in the Ohio State game, it was like, we're down. We just got scored on. Like, I have to roll my shoulders back and for the team to look at me and know that I'm confident, like we're good, which is a completely different animal.
Yeah. That's what's so crazy. Like a player like Karan, who just came in this year, and the situation she finds herself in she's a little bit older, right, than the normal freshman. Isn't she like a year older? I think she 18 or 19.
Yeah, I think she is. Cause she's French.
Yeah. So she had that 1 year, but still, to have those minutes and that pressure. So by the time she gets to where you are now, she's going to be like, piece of cake, you know, I guess. And everybody's makeup's different, how they handle stuff. But yeah, that's the progression though. That's why it makes like the normal route. The freshman comes in and learns. The sophomore gets a little bit of responsibility. The junior figures it out, starts to become a leader. The senior is then, you know, the top dog.
But you get that, like, you get that now. Like, I would always think back to my freshman year, and you'd see girls in practice and you'd be like, oh well, like, why is this sophomore not taking the senior spot? But it's like, in the game, when the emotions are high, like, who's gripping their stick too tight, who has the right ability and the confidence and the maturity to be like, okay, I've been here 10 times before. So you're so right, there's so much to that,
and the butterflies and everything else. It's just, yeah,
it's a lot.
So it's a lot. I will say, and that was the year that you had a big freshman class come in that year. That was Marbury, Sapola, Lalonde, Compton, Riley Jones, who we talked about, Blackmore, the Saboteur, Maddie Robertser. Yeah, that's when they all came in. That was a big freshman class, but I will say, and you added Becca Van Stone came over as well.
Yes.
I will say though that this year, now that you're the seasoned vet, everyone's looking at you, right? And I will say that this might be the most talented class coming in your time there in pure skill. You know, because Alina and Chloe, they were all ahead of you. No disrespect to the classes that have come in, but between the players coming in and Katie Davis and Jaden Bogdan coming over, that's a huge influx of talent. And when you talked about that anxiety, I can only imagine now some of the forwards must have had that anxiety coming in. I'm not pointing at anyone in particular, but that's got to be like, oh my gosh, now I got to beat out this kid, you know? So it's the same kind of thing. Do you have, like, is that something as one of the leaders of the team that you kind of keep an eye on the vibe, like a vibe check, and kind of try to keep it? I mean, I know we'll get to this, but I know you're one of the players that seems to have the most fun on the ice, the way you're always bopping and dancing and stuff. Is that something that you do? Is that just like an innate thing, or is that something you do like when people, you can feel them gripping it a little too tight?
I just think back to what I would have wanted my freshman year. And there were definitely girls that it was kind of like a corner of their eye, like, take a deep breath, I've been there before, like, you're good. And because everyone's doing their best to keep their emotions composed and not kind of let their fear and anxiety ooze into the emotions and the feelings in the room. So I think just like for me, like, I like I try to go over if someone's not doing great and just like squeeze them just to let them know, like, I acknowledge what you're feeling, but it's okay, like, type of deal. Yeah. I just think about what I would have wanted.
Yeah, for sure.
But I also too, like, cause you have biases, like, and there's a bias. And when you have your friends that you've been with for 5 years and then you have new girls that are coming in, kind of breathing down your friend's neck, you kind of think, how can I help them out? Like, how can I, and it's so weird. It's not that you intentionally try to make it bad, but you're like, okay, I'm going against this person in the corner and well, they're going to take the spot of this person. I'm going to go just a little bit harder against you or hey, like, so-and-so is like, their right knee is like not great. Keep going on their right side today. Something so stupid and so little, but like, okay, then let the best woman win.
Right
there. But I don't know. It's kind of like guerrilla warfare. It sounds like a bit, but like, it's just, it's so cutthroat when there's so many of us.
But that's what makes the program, right? And that's like Carp says all the time, it's like, you're playing an all-star team every night. You know, everyone you guys play, it's the best of the best. And it's something that you said that triggered this. There's two ways, right, that you can go on a divergent path. When you come in as a freshman, they kind of, you know, left you guys to swim or sink on your own. And you could have instilled that and said, that's the way we're doing things. But you then, like, you literally just said, how would I have wanted someone to handle that when I was a freshman? And it makes me think of when Sedano Chara came to the Bruins. He was like, we're all equal. There's no hazing. And he stopped all that. And I'm not saying you guys, there was no hazing. I don't mean it that way. I'm just saying it's a mindset and a reset and a way of doing things. And I think that speaks to you guys and the leadership of the team and the coaching staff to let you guys set that tone. And I think that's great. I one thing I've always said about the Huskies is that as good as they are on the ice, the people off the ice are equal. You know, it's just character.
Thank you. Thank you for saying that. Yeah, no, that's something that we definitely practice and we preach. That was something that my 5th years, they really wanted to implement was the tough love for sure. But there was support and it wasn't that we were going to try to drag anyone down in hopes of taking their spot. It was, hey, I'm going to give you all my secrets and I'm going to tell you all my tips and tricks. But even then, with all the information, I'm still going to beat you because I'm better than you. And I think that just kind of instills that competitor champion attitude, which I feel like we really try to embody.
And it's a heavy responsibility with the success the program's had that you guys want to leave it at a level. You don't want to leave it in tatters and be like, deuces, best of luck. You know what I mean? You don't want to do that, right? Yeah. It's something to be proud of and a legacy that you guys have built. So I reached out to some of your teammates and your coaches to talk, to get some more insight. Carp, grit. I asked the coaches for 3 words, right, to describe you, and Carp was grit, physical, fast. Pretty good. Berm was fast, tough, and relentless. And then Berm went back more to about how you have, you know, elevated yourself throughout your career to get to that top pair of minutes. Taze, the one common theme about you is like life of the party, goofball, but unapologetically yourself and true to yourself, which I think can be like one of the highest compliments that people can pay. I think when you're talking about your friends, it's that whole, like, you know who you are and you're comfortable with it and you're not changing it to fit other people. One of your other teammates asked me to ask you about your alter ego, Bon Jovi. Do you want to share? You don't have to.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like alter egos are something that you create yourself. It was more given to me. And I've slowly realized this year that it was kind of more like people were laughing at me, not necessarily with me. But at the time, I thought they were
laughing. I got set up then.
But no, I mean, no, it was not necessarily like I didn't come up with it, but I had a really bad haircut all last year. And it was just slowly.
Oh my God. All right, go ahead. Sorry.
No, you're good. It just was slowly a shorter and shorter mullet. And it was like, and everyone would just kind of call me Bon John because of my last name. And I just would always sing. And so it just, like, I'd come into the locker room and on the skateboard, it would be like, hey, number 16, get a new haircut. Things like that. So it was awesome. So I just, like, fed into it. I guess that's the thing. Like, if you can't stop them, join them.
Yeah.
So I'd perform a little John Bon Jovi before the games sometimes to get the girls fired up. But yeah.
I thought it was due to you singing. I apologize. I got
no. I mean, it is a little bit for sure.
Because you were one of the people, and I assume the camera guys at Matthews are aware that you like to sing, because you, whenever you're on the bench singing or whatever, face off, I don't even know if you notice, but you're on the Jumbotron, like your head is like the whole Jumbotron.
Never know.
Yeah, they zoom in on you all the time. And was it the Quinnipiac game? I think you started doing a bounce during a TV timeout at the face-off circle, and they ended up, all five of the Huskies on the ice were all doing the same bounce that you started. I don't even know if you were aware of that either.
No way. Oh, my God. That's hilarious.
So that's what I assumed the Bon Jovi thing was. I was like, oh, just because she sings and performs. Actually, I don't know if you – did you know – I don't know if you're a John Bon Jovi fan, but he saved some woman in Nashville. Did you see that?
Yeah, on like a bridge.
Yeah, and it was on National Suicide Prevention Day of random thing. Yeah, crazy.
Yeah, my teammates reached out to me. They're like, wow, you were a great person. And I was like, what do you mean? They're like, you saved someone. I was like, oh, my God. Love him.
That's great. All right, so you ready for some of the lightning round and the quick hits?
Yes.
All right, so this is the first. We'll do the team one. This is the quick hits.
Okay.
And you can answer yourself for any of these questions. And the reason you'll know why as soon as you hear the first one. Who's the best dressed on the team, the game day fit champ?
Ooh, I usually go with Taze, but this year I got to go with Holly Abella. She's really pushing the boundaries with fashion.
Nice. You named her this a lot. You get this one. You get named for this quite a bit. Who, if there is one, because I call this the Tessa Ward Memorial question, who's the biggest on-ice chirper on the team?
Ooh, Mia Lang. She has a potty mouth for sure.
Okay. Oh, you know what? That's true, because at the golf tournament, she sat down and immediately dropped. I don't know what, but she said something that I was like, dude. She's a funny one. And this one could be you also. Is there someone that keeps the team loose in like those tense moments?
Yeah. I mean, I think we have a lot of really awesome. We always have had, obviously, really awesome, funny girls. But Jules, Molly, Lily B, there's a bunch of girls that just like always are able to keep like a really light attitude, which is really fun.
Nice. I had to change the way I worded this because it was getting no answers. Who makes you better by going against them in drills at practice?
Ooh, it's a hard one. Everyone's so hard to go against, but I think Ellie Mombardi or Avery Anderson.
No.
They're just so small and shifty that as a defenseman, like I like to have one hand on my stick and I can't get my hand around them. Like I just like to grab players and I can't because they're just so shifty and they're good. They're very good.
Who's the best dancer?
Ooh, Lily B for sure. She's got some crazy moves.
Who would, in your opinion, who has the best hands?
Ooh, I think Elo, for sure. She has the best hands. Elo or Skurve.
Okay. Do you have any pregame rituals or superstitions, or is there anyone with some crazy ones that you're like, how do you make it through the day?
Not so much this year. Definitely in the past. There has been some girls with some crazy things. I guess my thing that's not necessarily crazy, I just like to have beet powder before the game. It's like just
beet? Like the root vegetable beet?
Yes, it's like pink.
Yeah. How do you have it? Just like with water or something?
I put it with some cherry juice and water. It's really good.
Does it taste like beets?
Yes. It doesn't taste good. It's just good. It makes me feel good.
Okay. So you're out in Cambridge, car breaks down, middle of the night. By yourself, one person on the team that you need, no matter the time, place, or location, who are you going to call?
Lily Shannon, without a hesitation.
Shannon, nice.
Yeah.
That was a sick goal she had, too, the other night. That was, I think Delaney put it out and then tagged SportsCenter, like trying to get it on SportsCenter, I believe.
Freaking should. It was disgusting. We were all like, what the hell?
Yeah, she, man, once I was talking to her dad, I think, before this game or the last game. Maybe I should talk to everybody's parents because I had a nice conversation with Mr. Brazis. Then Lily went out and scored her first goal like the next period. But I was talking to Mr. Shannon in the concourse, and I was like, dude, she is so close. When they come, it's going to be like in bunches. So, yeah, if you want, have your dad give me a call.
We can I was just going to say, if you talk to my dad, you
then. loose puck in the corner, and you and Coach Karp go in. Who's coming out?
Oh, me.
So
I would just drop everything. I would say screw the rules, and it would be a dark alleyway at night type of deal.
So this question always is the biggest smile from whoever is answering it. Even Alina was like, made like for her said something, you know, like that. But so when I interviewed Frankel, this just shows you how bad it was going. Like I told you before we started recording, I forgot to hit record. Then we got to here, and I go, because I can't. She's not going to go in the corner for a puck, right? So I say to her, hey, so Coach Karp tells me he can't shoot on you anymore in practice because it destroys your confidence. Any comment? Like, complete joke, clearly. She was like, oh, he said that? And I was like, oh, my God. I'm like, this can't go any worse. So I'd like to see her again.
Say that.
Yeah, I would like, I need to see her again to be like, I was like kidding around. We're not serious. But yeah. Oh, and I want to ask you, and this popped into my head this morning because you have so many imports now on the team. Have you seen the videos like on TikTok or whatever where they take foreign students, exchange students to the Spirit Halloween store because they don't know what it is?
No.
Oh my gosh, you have to look for it. I'm not saying you guys should do this because this might be bad, but they take like foreign exchange students to Spirit Halloween when all the stuff, like if you step on it, like the stuff jumps, you know what the Halloween.
Oh, yes, are. Yes.
So I was like, I wonder if Northeastern's doing that with the foreign kids. Like, hey, let's go look at Halloween decorations. That's popped in my head. Fantastic
idea.
Yeah, well, that's the morning skate difference. Things come in my head, straight out my mouth with no stopping. All right, so these are the lightning round for you, all right? Laces and tongues, in or out?
In.
Okay. Favorite cartoon character?
Ooh, Bugs Bunny.
Nice. Besides Northeastern, take Matthews right out of it. Favorite and least favorite rinks you've played in?
Ooh, least favorite, definitely Merrimack. And then favorite.
Because of the stealing? Is that why?
Just everything, the smell, everything. The people.
That's one of the few rinks that sells beer, too.
Actually? Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, they sell beer there. If they're in NCAA, yeah.
You'd think people would show up to games then.
Nice trip.
Literally, not even like their own band wants to show up.
They do have, who was it? Was it BC, I think, at the Beanpot 2 years ago? They brought like one guitarist and a drummer, and you guys had like your whole pep band. The one, it was at BC too.
Yes, I remember that. That was really bad.
Yeah. All right. So, what's your favorite rink?
My favorite rink, I really like Penn State or Minnesota Duluth.
Nice. Nice. Do you have a celebrity crush?
Honestly, not right now. No.
It's fine. Are you a dog or a cat person?
Definitely dog person.
All right. So now, because you answered dogs, compare the starting 6D to dogs based on personality.
The starting six.
You're the six. So you and Mariano, Jules and Allard, and then Jones and Candell and Thompson. Give me the dogs that line up with them.
Okay. Riley Jones would be a golden doodle. Christina would be an English cream golden retriever. Right. Jules would be a Rottweiler. Tori would be a Great Dane. I think I would be a French Bulldog.
Nice.
And then Tuva would be a Portuguese water dog. And then Tristan Thompson would just be a Bernese, one of those really big dogs that saves.
Oh, people. The Bernese Mountain Dogs?
Yes.
Yeah. Nice. That was good. I do like how all the pairs have a nice level of like grit too. There's, you know, there's you and Mariano. There's Jules with Allard. There's either Tuva or Tristan with Riley Jones. It's nice balance.
I agree.
What is a skill that you don't possess that you'd love to master?
I can't really do a toe drag.
Okay.
It's so bad to say I should be able to, but I just that'd be cool. But probably, probably would never ever do it in a game, but I might try it in practice.
Can you imagine though? If you hit it, oh, that'd be sick.
I did like a half one in like the zone for Beanpot. I remember just like a tiny half one. I was like, oh my god. But
what's your go-to pizza topping?
Ooh, I love bacon or pineapple.
Nice. Don't tell Eric about pineapple. Ooh. Black tape or white, and do you go heel to toe or toe to heel?
Heel to toe, and then white tape.
So I have to ask you this because I knew you were coming on. So I when maybe during a TV timeout or something, I noticed your stick, not at Holy Cross because it was normal, but the previous weekend, did you do something different? Because you had a stick that had one stripe of black and then white on the blade.
Yeah, so our sticks this year, the way they're painted, the actual shaft is like white and then like the blade is black. And so I just switched back to my old stick, but I just broke it, so I'll have to use my new stick.
Gotcha.
But yeah, it's
I didn't know if you would just put one like strip, and I'm like, what is that? No, all right, so I had a note to ask you about that. Guilty pleasure TV show or your most recent binge?
I just started watching Tell Me Lies. All my teammates are watching it. It's a pretty crazy show, but it's pretty good.
Okay. Would you rather be able to speak any language in the world or be able to talk to animals?
Talk to animals for sure. That'd be sick.
So we asked these guys at the golf tournament, and Lily Brazis said animals because she wants to know if her dog had an accent. Which I thought was the best answer. I've ever heard. I almost fell over. Is there a current NHL player that reminds you of your game?
I wouldn't say current, but definitely growing up, everyone would tell me I was just like Scott Stevens in the way that he played.
That's not a bad comp. If you ever go and watch like a YouTube video compilation of his hits, good Lord. He'd be suspended for years at a time nowadays.
Oh, sure.
All right. So start, bench, or cut. This is the NCAA clean version, right? Start, bench, or cut.
Okay.
Pancakes, waffles, French toast.
Start pancakes, cut French toast, bench waffles.
Okay. Waffles does not get a lot of love. Would you rather fight a horse-sized duck or 100 duck-sized horses?
100 duck-sized horses.
All right. Just a few more. Favorite pastime, not hockey-related?
I love baking.
Oh, yeah? Nice. Who would play you in a movie about your life?
Ooh, it would be probably Zooey Deschanel from New Girl.
Oh, yeah. If I ever met her or Jake Johnson, the first thing I would ask them is be like, what was Prince like? That would be the first question I'd ever ask. Because I don't know if you know, Prince was on the show
once. No, I didn't know that.
Oh, yeah. Prince, you should look that up. That episode was fantastic.
Ooh, okay, yeah.
When you watch it, Jake Johnson, I saw an interview with him where he said he wasn't acting. When his character met Prince, his reaction, he goes, that was not acting. That's how I really was.
No way. Okay.
Remember that when you watch. If you could live anywhere in the world, where would you pick?
California.
All right. Anywhere particular in California? Like north, south, my ocean, house, mountains?
And just like my like childhood home, which is just like right by the water.
There you go. If you could pick one superpower, what would it be? Besides the toe drag.
Probably to be invisible.
Okay. You can have a music festival, any band, artist, living or dead, the Yovo Festival. Give me your top three.
Ooh, probably be Tame Impala. Probably St. John and then Flume.
Okay. All right. And then the last one, most famous person on your phone, in your phone.
Ooh. I have a picture of my dad with Harry Styles.
No, but who's like a contact?
Oh, contact.
Like someone you could call. Not that you'd have to, you know.
Ooh. I was in class with Larry King's children. so I could call
Larry King, the old CNN guy.
Yeah.
Did the interviews.
Yeah.
I figured you were going to have something from growing up in California. I thought you were going to be like, oh yeah, Taylor Swift. Yeah. We talk every other week.
Yeah. She's my babysitter, you know.
Well, that's awesome. Thank you so much for doing that. So coming up this Friday is Providence at Providence.
Correct.
And then a Saturday off for the squad.
Yes. Looking forward. Hopefully the weather
will be Halloween.
Yes. Perfect.
Well, Lily, thank you so much for doing this. Like I say all the time, the best pound for pound hockey entertainment value in the city of Boston is at Matthews Arena for the women's game. $10 gets you all this and more. Thank you for coming on. Best luck the rest of the way, and appreciate you doing this.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. I had so much fun.
Oh, good. Awesome. All right. We'll see you next time.
Awesome. Sounds good. Thank you.